All right, so today we're going to talk about my fabulous sex life. One of the things that really grates on me when people, specifically straight people, want to talk to me about my sexuality, it's as if they don't understand on some level that if you're asking a queer person about their sexuality, you're basically inviting yourself into their bedroom. Now, I don't necessarily have a problem with people inviting themselves into my bedroom. It just seems to me that people should be more consciously aware that that is what they're doing when they want to talk to a queer person about their sex life. I also think it's important that I talk to you all about where I exist on this whole sexual orientation gender continuum. And who knows, it might be fun. I do want to hold up a trigger warning. Some of you who are not comfortable hearing about sex or hearing about sexuality may find this a very uncomfortable video. This is your opportunity to stop the video and watch something else. Also, I work with all kinds of people, young people, old people. I have family members of all ages who might be watching this and might get a little bit disturbed and feel uncomfortable about hearing me talk about these things. This is your opportunity to stop the video and go to the Disney Channel. My sexual beginnings. I guess the first experience that I can look back on as an adult and consider a sexual experience was when I was young. There was an uncle who used to take care of us. Now, don't get upset, family members. I'm not about to make a big, huge revelation. But we did have this uncle who used to take care of us, and I don't think he had the most appropriate sense of how to play with kids and how to behave around kids. There was certainly an incident when my dad walked in and I was stretched out on a pool table, and I don't know, I may or may not have had my shorts closer to my knees than they were supposed to be. Anyway, that uncle was never charged with taking care of us again. Not anything that I look back on and find profoundly disturbing, but it's certainly not something that I would ever do or condone that any other adult do if they are left with children in their care. If kids want to play doctor, that's one thing. Adults, stay out of it. I don't remember consciously thinking about myself as a girl when I was small, but I was constantly engaging with other kids in make-believe, and in that make-believe, I was always identifying as a girl. There was nothing more fun for me than fantasy play where I was a woman in peril being saved by a whole gang of like rowdy boys. Interestingly enough, when I was a kid, and we're talking about like, you know, 5, 6, 7 years old, the other boys that I would play with didn't seem to find it unusual that I was always wanting to be like Susie and be rescued. In fact, it was just what was expected. And it wasn't until we started to get older that people, I think, started to maybe become a little self-conscious about that, and my brothers and my dad started to put pressure on me not to want to identify as a girl. Certainly, if it were today, I would be one of those kids who was making a decision about which bathroom I wanted to use, that's for sure. So I would say probably around the time I was like 8, 9, and 10, it stopped being this kind of open play where I was playing with identifying as a girl and became more about like some of the other boys on the block wanting to find like private time with me and, you know, make out in the way that a 8, 9, 10 year old makes out. I definitely wouldn't consider it like losing my virginity, but it was certainly not the kind of thing that most of the boys wanted to admit to engaging in with the, you know, 8, 9, 10 year old who was me, who was still kind of not clear about how I was identifying in terms of gender. So somewhere in there, culturally, I was being pushed in the direction of identifying as a male, and I even saw myself trying to mimic the way that other boys were behaving. I would pretend that I was, you know, dating other girls in my class and who were likely not very interested in me, but kind of went along with it anyway. My first kiss, in fact, was with a girl in the third grade. I think it was like the third grade or something like that. And for me, it was a big deal. Certainly, I remember the kiss, and I remember the person, and I remember the name of the person. I will withhold the name because I don't want to embarrass this person in case they're still around and somehow come across this video. And then when I reached puberty, something really odd happened. My body didn't develop the way the other boys' bodies were developing. I was developing far more like an intersex person than either a male or a female. And that was something that was really scary to me, but something that people people in my family weren't really prepared to talk about. It was something my mom just kind of brushed aside. And because I didn't, you know, see anyone else like me, and there was no access to the internet to just look things up, there was no one that I could really talk to, and there was no way for me to really identify what was happening with my body. I certainly had like normalized men and women commenting on the fact that I didn't necessarily read as a boy or as a girl, and that was a pretty weird place to be in as a kid. I think most people in my family would not even admit to remembering me going through a period like that because it was something that was just so suppressed. But as the person who was living that experience, I certainly remember, like, I'm growing breast right now. I'm growing breast. And I'm the only boy that I know who is growing breast. What is going on here? My body wasn't even forming. I wasn't developing muscle even in the way that other boys develop muscle. It was a very bizarre place to be, and it's certainly amazing that I got through that period. I certainly remember being quite pained about it, terribly lonely, terribly self-conscious about it. I remember being mocked often by other boys because there I was in this, you know, boys' gym and sharing a shower with these boys who were commenting on my body as if I was not one of them, but I certainly wasn't going to be sent to, you know, like the girls' gym, the girls' washroom. I feel like there was a lot of pressure on me from people around me to kind of show that I was normalizing somehow as a boy and wanted to see me engaging with girls in a sexual way. I remember my first sexual encounter was with the girl who lived in the house next door to mine, and it was almost like she was kind of, you know, the guy traditionally, and that she was very, very much putting pressure on me to, you know, have sex with her. And I was very, very uncomfortable with it, but eventually gave in because I just, you know, I was very uncomfortable with someone putting that much pressure on me, and it was for something that they were pretending was not a very big deal, but to me it was a huge deal. It may also have something to do with, you know, going to Catholic school for most of my elementary schooling. But regardless, I do certainly identify with this whole idea of sort of date rape and rape culture, what it's like to be in the position where you are feeling like something is wrong with you for not submitting to what this other person wants from you. That also was very late in life. I believe I was 16 or 17 when that happened. Of course, I had had all of these moments with like other boys who were closer to my age from when I had been very young, but I didn't consider those really sexual encounters. They were really just kind of moments of like cuddling with, you know, some guy who wanted to pretend for a minute that they were with, you know, a girl. I don't know, whatever that was. But this pressure and this first sexual encounter was something that I consider, you know, really shameful and really kind of traumatic. I didn't really think about sex or pursue sex in any way after that first sexual encounter. It definitely wasn't something that I was, you know, obsessed with like a lot of kids my age, like a lot of teens. I was perfectly happy to go back to being, you know, pretty prepubescent in my thinking about sex, especially since I, you know, had this, you know, really weird body that I didn't want to show anyone. Then I had this weird experience when I was, I was 16 or 17, and I was, at that point I had started my training as an actor. I was, you know, doing classes and workshops that I could afford or that were free. And I was doing a performance, I was doing a public performance in like a park. And at one point, someone came up to me after the performance and they were just, you know, talking to me. And I figured, you know, this was somebody who was just interested in the show. And then they jumped on me. Literally, this person jumped on me, like threw me on the ground. And I didn't know what it was about, but I think and felt that it was definitely sexual. It was definitely sexual. And it took a whole crew of people to pull this person off of me. I remember they were very tall, and people who don't know me should understand that I'm an extremely tall person. So if I thought someone was tall, they were probably gigantic. And then I started actually seeing this person all over the place. And then it occurred to me after, you know, weeks, months maybe of seeing this person that they were stalking me. And of course I didn't have the language of stalking to tell people about it. I just knew that there was this person who had physically attacked me in this space. I was seeing them in the places that I frequented. And there was an incident where I was at, I was in a department store, and this was pre-mall days. I was in a department store with some friends of mine, and this person showed up in the department store and followed us all around the department store. Now, at the time, I was a teenager, and this was somebody who I would have considered an adult. So again, it was profoundly disturbing to have this person pursuing me in this very predatory way. And it did end up with, like, me at night having this person come up on me and being kind of pulled into the bushes and ending up in a, like, physical sexual encounter with this person. Now I would categorize what happened to me as a rape, but of course at the time I didn't have the language for that, and I had really no understanding of what was going on. And to be honest with you, I thought for some reason that it was my fault, that somehow I had done something or had projected something that had this person interested in me, or had, you know, called, you know, brought down this person on me in some way. And then the person kind of, I guess once that encounter happened, maybe the person was disturbed or troubled or fearful of what I might do or say, and they disappeared. I do remember during the encounter the person saying, you know, you're actually older than the type of guy I'm normally interested in. Which leads me to believe that the person was probably just a full-on pedophile. So not long after that, I ended up in a relationship with someone that I had been working with in a play. It was an older woman, a woman who was twice my age, and since I was, I believe, 17 at the time, a lot of stuff happened when I was 17. Since I was 17 at the time, that probably would have qualified as statutory rape. But of course, you know, I didn't have any of these terms. I didn't really have any understanding of the legal implications of what, you know, was happening at that time, happening to me, or that I was engaging in. I certainly felt like I was consenting in the case of that relationship. But there was so much emotional and psychological abuse that came with that relationship that I definitely would not, I wouldn't recommend that kind of relationship for anyone. There's just too much potential for the person who's older to take advantage of the younger person. Now, I don't wanna categorize the person that I was involved with in that relationship. That relationship went on for like 2 years off and on, so I don't want to categorize that person as bad, but I definitely think it was probably not so good for either one of us, and certainly not good for me. I carried around a lot of guilt after that relationship, and I think I do still carry around some guilt, but thinking back on it, you know, I was 17, I was not legally an adult, and that person was twice my age at the time and was legally an adult, and so they probably carry a little bit more of the responsibility for that than I do. Shortly after that, I had, I guess, what you would call my first boyfriend, and I guess that was when I had fully embraced the idea of being a queer man, I guess, a queer man, even though I don't recall ever being asked how I was identifying in terms of gender, but I guess man will do. And this relationship lasted for a fairly long time, at least 2 years. I ended up living with the person who turned out to be a creep. They were not very faithful, and this was in the 80s when it was really kind of frightening to think of being in a relationship with someone who wasn't being faithful. It was a very scary time to be, you know, having one's, you know, full sexual awakening, and that has probably had a lot to do with the way I think about sex now. I started having friends who were infected with HIV. Some of those friends are still here, and a lot of those friends are not. It was also a time when we were hearing about a lot of celebrities who had been presumed straight, who suddenly had been afflicted with HIV and were dying from complications from AIDS. So after that relationship ended, I went back to being a pretty much asexual person. That was a little bit my default mode back then. In fact, I never pursued anyone. If someone didn't come on to me, I wasn't gonna be connecting at all in any kind of sexual way with someone. In fact, my next significant relationship was also someone who kind of came on to me, but this was, you know, the person who I consider the artist. This was actually one of the kind of most amazing people that I've ever had a relationship with in my life, and I still credit that person with a lot of who I am, especially in terms of my creativity. So that was probably one of my healthier relationships, but I'm sure by that time I had been so kind of traumatized and scarred by the relationships that I had had leading up to it that I probably wasn't ready to be a good partner to this really amazing person. So by now I'm an undergrad, I'm in a conservatory program, I've had two significant partners, one who was a complete scoundrel, the other who was this really amazing person whose life I probably made a nightmare of because I wasn't emotionally mature enough or psychologically in the right place to be in a healthy relationship. That relationship did last into graduate school, into my being in graduate school. About a year into being in my graduate program, I realized that that relationship was just not going to work for me. You know, I continued to be someone that I think was looked on by others as being a very sexual being, while the reality was I was still pretty, you know, defaulting to this kind of asexual place. I made it through graduate school, I think having one long distance boyfriend who I ended up like living with for a summer in Providence, Rhode Island, of all places. And that was great, but somehow in the middle of that, they ended up in a relationship with someone else, and that was horrible. So I went back to being single and being more focused on developing myself creatively than I was at all interested in being really in a relationship with anyone or pursuing anyone sexually. And it wasn't until I got out of graduate school, moved to New York, and got really my first job and really started working as an actor that I started thinking of myself not only as a person who was a sexual being with some agency, but someone who was like interested in pursuing people. My general mode of seduction, however, was always just kind of put myself in a place where there were likely to be people interested in me, and then whoever kind of came up to me, that was who I would end up with. And this continued for quite some time, and it's something that I kind of still carry with me. I'm not someone who's very predatory as far as sexually engaging goes. I think I had maybe one experience where I like really pursued someone in a really kind of, you know, in a really aggressive way, and I still carry this terrible guilt about it. In fact, I was thinking about it recently and I was like, would that have been considered like date rape? I don't know. I hope not, but if I saw the person, I would probably apologize. Like again, I really still carry a lot of guilt around the first time that I actually actively pursued someone and aggressively kind of pushed myself onto someone. So somewhere in there, I met my husband. We'd actually been in a relationship for close to 20 years before he became my husband. I'm not gonna talk too much about our personal lives, certainly not our sex lives, because, you know, I wanna be respectful of his privacy, but I hope that gives you guys an idea of where I'm coming from as a sexual being, how I identify. You can think about me not so much as just like this gay guy, but somebody who has like a very clear and specific sexual identity, a very specific and clear kind of gender identity, I hope. And I certainly hope before the next time, if you're someone who identifies as heterosexual, before you walk up to somebody who identifies as something other than that, when you're asking them about their sexual orientation, about their gender identity, you're probably really asking for more information than you're ready to hear. So I am happy to answer any questions that any of you might have about my orientation or my thoughts about my own gender. Please leave your questions in the comment section. That's it for this video. Like it if you like it. Share, comment, subscribe. This is Reg signing off. Love yourself. Peace.